Open your Bibles, if you will, this morning to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 2. And in your hearing, I want to read the first 12 verses. And I read this Lord's Day morning from the New International Translation of the Holy Scriptures. Mark chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. So many gathered that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralytic, carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus, and after digging through it, lowered the mat the paralyzed man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts. And he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat, and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, 'I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home.' He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. And this amazed everyone. And they praised God, saying, 'We have never seen anything like this.'" We have never seen anything like this. You may return to your seated places. I want to preach this morning, as the Lord gives me strength and passion, "By any means necessary." By any means necessary. For those of you who grew up, as I did in the 1960s, this particular phrase, "by any means necessary," is familiar. It was a phrase often uttered by the late Malcolm X. And it was a phrase that he would use when addressing what is our full press towards freedom and equality in this republic that we call the United States of America. Contrary to what many people believe, these words, this phrase, was not originated with Malcolm X, but it goes back some 100 years before he was born. It was first uttered by an African-American Presbyterian preacher whose name was Henry Highland Garnett. And these words were uttered sometime around 1842. And by anybody's standards of that day, this day, or even in the 60s, it was a radical phrase. Its very implication and inference seems to suggest that in our bold quest for freedom, even perhaps violence could be employed. And for that reason, many of us who are a part of the Christian enterprise found ourselves shunning that particular phrase and shying away from him. People like Richard Allen and Absalom Jones could not in any way identify with that phrase, because in their particular way of thinking, that phrase was far too radical. And there are those who live today who honestly believe that the employment of that phrase is yet important as we struggle for yet what is full equality in this country. I'm not come today to debate the pros and cons of the phrase, But I come today to lift it because I think it has meaning and purpose to the text that I want to lift today out of New Testament antiquity. For those of us who've been a part of the Christian church for any period of time, we recognize that in this second chapter of Mark, at the very commencement of our Lord's ministry, something wonderful is taking place. People are captivated by his preaching. They are tremendously uplifted by what is his teaching. And yet, in addition to what is both his preaching and his teaching, there is something unusual about this young rabbi from Nazareth who is able to do the miraculous. Now, I recognize this morning that I preach to a sophisticated, educated crowd, and there are many of us who really don't believe in the supernatural power of the Lord Jesus Christ. But I believe there are a few witnesses in the building who can attest that God is still a healer. God is able to touch minds. God is able to touch bodies. God is able to touch spirits and make us whole again. In the second chapter, there is a paralytic, a man who is paralyzed from his waist down, from his head down. There is no mobility, there is no activity in his limbs. And yet word has come to him and to several of his friends that this young rabbi from Nazareth is now in Capernaum. The crowds have swollen to such an enormous degree that the house in which Jesus is preaching and teaching cannot be entered. The crowd has overflowed outward. And in order to get to Jesus, these men, who are not acquaintances but friends, travel up the stairway alongside the house. And the house is made of stone, but the roof is made of mud and straw, which explains how they are able to dig a hole through it and place before the Lord this paralytic man who is in need of the healing that only Christ can give. Allow me to say parenthetically that there is a qualitative difference between someone that you defined as an acquaintance and somebody that you defined as a friend. An acquaintance is simply somebody who comes within the orbit of your life and may well be there for a utilitarian motive, meaning that there is something that they want from you. There is something that they want out of you. But these men who have gathered this paralytic and who carry him on their shoulders to the house in Capernaum where our Lord is, these are not acquaintances. These are friends. They have the paralytic's well-being before them. They are concerned about his welfare. And when the crowds have swollen to such a feverish pitch, to the point that they are not able to get to the crowd, they go up the stairwell, dig a hole through the roof, and place him before the Lord. Now, what is interesting about the text is that when they place the paralytic before the Lord, they do not utter one word. Nothing is said. Not one word comes forth from their lips. They just deposit him and back away from it. The Lord has the uncanny ability, doesn't he, to see genuine need when it is placed before him. One does not need a lot of dialogue. One does not need a lot of verbiage. Whenever you have a legitimate need and you place it before the Lord can look beyond what is your exterior and see what is on the inside. And the record is that while the man lies there, notice that Jesus does not first heal the man. Healing is not the first item on the agenda. The first item on the agenda is to forgive the man of his sin. For the infirmity, the affliction, the sickness with which he lives is derivative of that Adamic thing that happened years ago in the bowels of Eden. It erupts out of that thing we call original sin. Come on, don't look at me like I'm crazy. All of us are sinners this morning. We might be dressed up, but we are still sinners saved by grace. And if you don't have anything else to shout about this morning, you ought to shout that he brought you out of darkness into the marvelous light of his grace. Doesn't matter who you are, who you think you are, all have sinned. I said, all have sinned. I said, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But thanks be to God, we have a Savior who is in the house this morning, and he is still forgiving sins. Can I get a witness? I said, can I get a witness? Does anybody feel like I feel this morning? What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Jesus looks at the paralytic, and he says to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven. Notice the text says that there are teachers of the law in the assembly. Erudite men, educated men, men who are schooled in the law of the Torah. They don't verbalize, they don't articulate out loud what it is that they are thinking. But remember, the Lord can look beyond the exterior. And Mark reports that he unmasked their thinking. And their thought is, who is this young upstart? Who is this rabbi from Nazareth? Who is this man who does not have any degree from an accredited theological institution forgiving sin? Nobody has the power to forgive sins except God himself. And the Lord reads the radar of their thinking. And he registers out loud what they are thinking in their own private state. And he says, which is the right thing? To forgive the man of his sins, or to tell him, take up his mat and walk? And Jesus totally disregards these teachers of the law. He disses these religious sophisticates. And he tells the man, not only are your sins forgiven, but pick up your mat, get out of here, and go home. But I come today not to wrestle with why the teachers thought the way they thought. My issue is with these four men who place their paralytic friend before Jesus, who have come to Jesus because they want their friend healed by any means necessary. Now, some of you can sit up here like bumps on a log this morning if you choose. But I got out of my bed and I came to Bethel this morning after 170 years because I still want my blessing. And I want my blessing by any means necessary. So I would advise you this morning to take a pew check right about now. And if somebody hadn't moved yet, you give yourself elbow room. Because you need to tell everybody on your pew, I came this morning to be blessed. I came this morning to be helped. I came this morning to be healed. I came this morning to be delivered. And somebody came up in here today to be saved. And I came by any means necessary. I've gone through too much hell this week not to be blessed this morning. I gathered my garments about my back, made my way through the streets of Jacksonville because I believe there's a blessing in this house. And I'm not going to let you or anybody else get in my way. I'm going to get my blessing by any means necessary. Sit down, sit down, sit down. What is it in these four men that pushes them to bring their paralytic friend to Jesus? Why is it so necessary that they present him to Jesus for healing? The first thing that the text suggests to me is they bring their paralytic friend to be healed by Jesus because they understood that life is never to be lived in the horizontal. We are born to live in the vertical dimension of life. Anybody who lives in the horizontal lives an immobile life, an inactive life. And the only persons who live in that horizontal position, who live in that prone position, are babies who must lie in their crib and cradle. Children and grown-ups when they sleep. People who are infirmed and who have not the activity of their limbs and the mobility and of body to move. Prone horizontal people ultimately are people who are asleep or dead. God never called us to live life in the horizontal dimension. Here is a man who lives flat on his back every day that God sends. And the only good thing that we can say about his horizontal posture is that even in a horizontal position, he's still able to lift up his eyes unto the hill, from whence cometh his help. Come on, I'm awake now. I feel like preaching. And he's able to say, all of my help comes from the Lord. But how many of us this morning are physically vertical, but spiritually horizontal? And because we are spiritually horizontal, we are not living in the vertical dimension of mobility, activity, and ministry. God has called you to do more than occupy a pew on Sunday morning in worship. But too many of us are paralyzed in spirit, and we are crippled psychologically, emotionally, and spiritually, and we are the walking dead. You know folk, as I know folk, who have allowed life to so immobilize them that spiritually they are living on a horizontal plane. May I preach this morning? People who are chemically dependent are living horizontally. People who are crippled and immobilized because of some past abuse are living horizontally. People with low self-worth and low self-esteem are living horizontally. But God has called us to pick up our mats and to lift ourselves from a prone position and to stand up vertically and declare, I can do all things. Not some things, not a few things, but doggone it, I can do all things through Jesus Christ who strengthens me. Do I have about 25 people up in Bethel this morning who know something about getting up out of a crippled state, who know something about rising up from a horizontal position, who know something about the healing, helping, saving, and delivering power of the Lord Jesus Christ? Somebody ought to shout this morning, he's able. I said he's able. He's able to do exceeding and abundantly beyond anything that I can think, dream, or imagine. Life is not meant to be lived in the horizontal. Look at Job. Life tried to reduce him to the horizontal. He lost his wealth. All of his children died in one setting. His health was attacked with agonizing sores and scabs from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. And on top of all of that, his soulmate, his wife, has the unmitigated gall to tell him, curse God and die. He could have bowed out and positioned himself emotionally, psychologically, and spiritually on a horizontal mat. But I hear Job saying, the Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. But blessed, I said blessed, blessed be the name of the Lord. Because Job declared, and when he has tried me, I shall come forth as pure gold. That's why Bethel has been a praise house for 170 years. Way back in 1838 when you were founded, prior to emancipation, a group of African Americans got together and decided that they were not going to live in a horizontal plane.
Slavery and indentured servitude was not going to be their lot, because they had somebody who was greater than the slave master. I got another master, and his name is Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. I am not meant to live life in the horizontal position. Look at what else the text is. These men said, we must get our paralytic friend to the Lord by any means necessary, because life is never meant to be lived totally dependent on somebody else. This paralytic can do absolutely nothing for himself. He needs assistance when he eats. He needs assistance in order to drink water. He needs assistance to dress his body. He needs assistance to bathe his frame. He needs assistance to take care of all of his bodily functions. Can you imagine how utterly frustrating that must be? To be totally incapacitated that you can't lift one finger in order to assist you in the things that you and I take for granted. Something's wrong with any human being to whom God has given gift, a talent, ability, and resource, and you live totally dependent on somebody else. They bring the paralytic to Jesus because not only do they want him in a vertical position, but they want him to be able to become self-sufficient. We need self-sufficiency. Babies are totally dependent. Children are totally dependent. Sick, infirmed, afflicted people who cannot do for themselves need dependency. But for those of us who have a reasonable portion of our health and strength, you may not have all the gifts of the Spirit. Nobody does, but everybody got at least one. And rather than always depend and lean on somebody else, you need to be able to move away from dependence to independence. Y'all not feeling me. When I graduated from high school, my mother had a serious discussion with me. And it really wasn't a discussion. It was a monologue. There was nothing dialogical about this conversation. She sat down and she said, you've made me proud. 17 years old, getting ready to graduate, but I want you to know that you have three options before you on the day you graduate from high school. Option number one, get a job. Option number two, go into the military. Option number three, go to college. There is no fourth option, because once you march across that stage with that diploma in your hand, you are out of my house. I have raised you for 17 years. I have fed you. I have clothed you. I have taken care of you. I have put in you all the best that I can. And now, with the help of God, you must cease to be dependent on me and be dependent on God and what God has given you. Something has gone awry in the black community. Something has gone amok in the African American community. Come on, let's have church. We are raising a generation of African American men who are nothing more than gigolo. And some of you crazy women, let them be that. The woman is not supposed to be taking care of the man. The man ought to be taking care of the woman. God raises up. Help me some. I said God raises up to become totally dependent on him. Can I get a witness? I said, can I get a witness? How many of you still believe if there's a will, there is a way? How many of you know God can do anything but fail? Does anybody have a testimony that he can open a door that nobody can shut? And when he gets good and ready, he can shut that same door so that nobody can open it. Life is to be lived. Never totally dependent on others except if your circumstances necessitate it. Sit down, sit down. July 27th, 2004, in the convention center in Boston, Massachusetts, a young junior senator from the state of Illinois by the name of Barack Obama strolled onto the platform of the Democratic National Convention to give the keynote address. He was a little known politician. But he stood on the stage in 2004 with a keynote address, and what pushed him into prominence was that speech in which he said that there are no red states, there are no blue states, there is only the United States of America. Dr. McKissick Sr., I shall never forget listening to him on that beautiful night, and I listened to Tim Russert and Tom Brokaw, who said, that young man has a future. He might one day run for the presidency of the United States. But they thought it was way down the line. Hold it, hold it. In 4 years, without the backing of the prominent people in the Democratic Party. In 4 years, without the backing of our dominant black leaders, that young man from Illinois put together a political campaign that on January the 20th will put him in the Oval Office in the White House. And he'll become the first African-American president in our republic. Somebody ought to shout right now that it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others. I feel like running around this church. Somebody ought to slap five with somebody and tell them this morning, God is able. I said, God is able. Just because the big wigs don't back you don't mean that you can't make it. With God, all things. Somebody ought to give him an all things praise this morning. How many of you know with God, all things are possible? We've got to get our friend to Jesus. Because life is not meant to be lived in the horizontal. We got to get our friend to Jesus. Because life is not meant to be totally dependent on others. But finally, and I bid you good morning, we got to get him to Jesus. Because he's our last resort. We've exhausted every other option. We no longer have money for medicine. Doctors are out of the question. Every conceivable medical instrument has been employed. Every conceivable medical idea has been employed. No convalescent center, no rehabilitation place will take him. Medicaid and Medicare have run out. We're in a recession. We've got to get him to Jesus because there is no other option. That sounds like good news to me. That when all else fails, when your intellect fails, when your political connections fail, when your economic security fails, when your pedigree fails, when your associations fail, there is a final resort. Story is told of a young man who went to the National Museum of Art, and he looked up on the wall and he saw a painting that arrested his attention. He stood there and he looked at the painting. 1 hour passed, 2, 3, 4 hours, but he just stood there. This was the painting. It was entitled Checkmate. And there was a board with chess items on it. And on one side of the board was a young man with a rather pathetic and pitiful look on his face. On the other side of the table was the menacing, sinister glare of Satan himself, with his fingers together looking into the eyes of the young man. And the painting was entitled Checkmate. The guard in the museum kept coming by looking at this young man, wondering, why in the name of God is he just staring at this painting? The guard came to him and said, in a couple of hours, we're closing. The young man stood there about 5 minutes before the gallery closed, Ferdinand. The guard came around the corner and heard the young man holler, "It's a lie." The guard said, "What do you mean, it's a lie?" He looked at the painting. He said, "I play chess, and I've been standing here looking at that chessboard, looking at all of those bishops and those rooks, and I've discovered that it's a lie. It's not checkmate. He's got one more move. I'm going to tell somebody, you got one more move. I don't care how much hell you're going through, you got one more move. I don't care what your trials are, you've got one more move. I don't care what your temptations and your tribulations are, you've got one more move." Does anybody feel like giving God praise? Because God will always give you one more move. Somebody ought to get up on your feet right now, throw back your head, and praise God that in Christ you've got one more move. Why don't you look at somebody and slap five with them and tell them, "I'm not going to sink today because God has given me one more move." Somebody ought to praise God. Somebody ought to magnify God. You got to the church this morning because God gave you. I said God gave you. I said God gave you one more move. Somebody ought to praise him right about now. Can I get a witness in here? The road is rough. Yeah. And the going gets tough. And the hills are hard to climb. Oh, yeah. But I started out a long time ago. And there is no doubt in my mind. I've decided. I said, I've decided. I said, I've decided to make Jesus my choice. Can I get a witness? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. I said, on Christ, not my politics. On Christ, not my economics. On Christ, not my education. On Christ, not the hat on my head. On Christ, not the clothes on my back. On Christ, not the shoes on my feet. On Christ, not the ring on my finger. On Christ, not the car that I drive. On Christ, not the house that I live in. On Christ, not my assets, but on Christ, the lily of the valley. On Christ, the bright and morning star. On Christ, my sanctification, my justification. Somebody ought to help me. On Christ, on Christ, on Christ, on Christ. Say yeah, 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 say yeah. Come on, look at somebody, look at somebody. Tell them I'm gonna get mine by any means necessary. I'm gonna get my blessing by any means necessary. Now shout, I've got one more move. I've got one more move. I've got one more move. I've got it. 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 I don't know about you, but I've got one more move. When you think I'm down, I've got one more move. That's why I just had to stand back and just shout over one more move. Somebody ought to say, I know that's right. Come on, give him praise. Come on, give him praise. You ought to give him praise.
praise just because he's giving you one more move. To look three people and just tell them and put that thing up and tell them, I got one more move. Now listen, I think this is a great moment. This is a great moment, having heard that powerful message. This is a great moment for us to tell any person who is not in Christ, you got one more move. I wish I could get some hollering and shouting Christians say, I took advantage of that one more move. You might be in here this morning. You might be in here this morning, and God may not give you another chance, but you do have it now. You ought to come down these aisles running, walking, whatever it takes. But by whatever means, you ought to just leave right now and say, Jesus, I'm coming now. Come on, come on.
Subscribe to Brother Rollins' videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it. B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins videos for Christ on YouTube.